Okay, so we are now going to talk about some of the key ratios that we have to use whenever we are talking about the working capital. So I'm repeating it again. I'm going to talk about few of the key ratios that we are going to use when we are talking about the working capital. Basically what happens is, remember this thing, that whenever you are using the ratios, so there is a way to use the ratios, which is that you have to compare the result of your ratio. Whatever ratios that you calculate, you have to compare it. Compare it with what? Compare it with the budgeted figures, or compare it with the last year figures, or compare it with the competitor or the industry, etc. Till the time you don't compare your ratios are going to be meaningless. So the first rule for the ratios is that you have to compare them. The first rule for the ratios is that you have to compare them. Now, let's talk about it. Let's discuss about it. So the first ratio that we talk about is the current ratio. And what is the formula for the current ratio? It's your current assets upon the current liabilities. So for example, if you have got, let's say, $4,000 worth of current asset, and if you have got, let's say, $3,000 worth of current liabilities. I'm repeating it again. You have got $4,000 worth of current assets, and you've got $3,000 worth of current liabilities. So what is actually going to happen is, 4,000 divided by 3,000 would give you 1.33 is to 1. Now, what exactly do you mean by this 1.33 is to 1? This actually tells us that we have $1.33 of current assets settle $1 of current liability. So what does it tell you? It tells you that you have got $1.33 of current assets available to settle $1 of the current liability. You have got $1.33 of the current assets available to settle $1 of the current liability. Now let's try to discuss this. Basically, what is going to happen is this current ratio a good current ratio? Is this current ratio a good ratio? Is it showing a good status of the business? So the answer is, it actually depends upon with whom are you comparing. Are you comparing it with your budget? Are you comparing it with your last year? Are you comparing it with your industry? So it could actually depend upon that how your industry operates. It could depend upon how your budget is. It could depend upon how your company was performing in the last year. So all of those are going to be the factors which would decide whether you are performing well or not. So when we talk about the concept of current ratio, so the current ratio would actually be current assets upon current liabilities. It's actually current assets upon current liability telling us how much of the current assets are available, how much of the current assets are available to settle a dollar of current liabilities. Okay, now let's move a bit forward and try to discuss about the quick ratio. So what is the difference between the current ratio and the quick ratio? It's only that the current assets less inventory, it's actually your quick assets. What exactly is it? It's actually your quick assets. So when we talk about the concept of quick assets, so let's try to understand this. For example, if you have got the current assets of 4,000, and if you have got 2,000 of the inventory, and if you have got 3,000 of current liabilities, that means 0.67 is to 1 is what your quick ratio is. Now, what is it indicating? It's indicating you have got $0.67 of quick assets to settle $1 of current liability. It's actually $0.67 of quick assets to settle $1 of current liability. Now let's try to understand this thing. Basically, why do we calculate quick ratio when we have already calculated the current ratio? To try to understand this. For example, if you have got inventory available with you, which is happening with a lot of companies right now due to COVID-19. And if your employees come to you and they ask you for the salary, and you tell them that, see, we run a supermarket, so you can pick up whatever you want to pick up for your family, and you can adjust your salary accordingly from it. The employee is going to say that there are many cash things that we have to manage. So it's not just going to be that we can pick up things from supermarket and we'll be living in a proper manner. We can't do it. So the concept that I'm trying to explain to you people is that if there is an inventory, the inventory is not immediate cash. It's not a liquid item. It requires to be sold first and then converted to cash. So inventory is not your quick current asset. Your quick current assets are current assets less the inventory, which is your receivables and the cash. That's what your quick assets are. Is that okay now? Okay, both of them are important. Both of them are important. Basically, both are measures which are used in the industry. As I told you, that you can't just rely on one single element. You have to consider everything, because you will be comparing your business's performance with that of the industry. You will be comparing your business's performance with that of your competitors. So if your competitors are using these ratios, so you might have to use them. If the industry in which you are operating, current ratio is more used, so you have to go for using this. But the objective is that both of these ratios are important and are a good measure of your liquidity. Now let's move a bit forward and let's try to discuss further. Then we have got further ratios which include receivable collection period, the payable payment period, and the inventory holding period. If I talk about each one of them, which is the receivable collection period, which is the payable payment period, and the inventory holding period. So what exactly is the formula? So if you have got receivables of, let's say, 1,000, and the sales were actually of 5,000, you multiply it with 365. So resultingly, you end up getting 71 days approximately, or 70 days. Now, what does this receivable collection period tells you? The receivable collection period actually tells you time taken by customer. I am taken by customer to settle from the date of purchase. I am taken by the customer to settle from the date of purchase. So the date when you actually purchase the goods. I'm repeating it again. The date when you sell the goods. So the time your customer takes in order to make payment to you from the date of sale. So that is actually going to be considered as your receivable collection period. Now, should it be long? Should it be short? So remember, the shorter it is, the better it is. Why? Because if you give longer term credit, there is a risk of bad debt. If you give longer term credit, there is an opportunity cost of funds involved. Now, what exactly do you mean by opportunity cost of funds involved? If this money would have been available to you, you could have deposited it into the bank and you could have earned interest on this money. So if your money is stuck with your customer, he's not going to make any interest payment to you. So if he is actually not going to make any interest payment to you, so that means you have an opportunity cost of funds. You could have earned the interest by depositing the funds into the bank. So remember, the shorter it is, the better it is. So that's an important thing with respect to the receivable collection period. Okay, let's move a bit forward and try to discuss about the payable payment period. How do we calculate it? We calculate it like this. Trade payables divided by COGS. If you are given the figure of purchases in the question, you'll be using purchases. But if you are not provided the figure of purchases, you'll be using the cost of goods sold. So again, let's say you've got 500 million of payables and the cost of sales is, let's say, 4,000 million. You multiply it with 365 days. You multiply it with what? 365 days. So now let's try to understand. If it is actually 500 divided by 4,000, into 365, you get approximately 45, 46 days. What does it tell you? It tells us the time taken to make payment to supplier from the purchase date. So it actually tells you the time it takes you to make payment to supplier from the date of purchase. Now, the question that actually arises is that should it be longer, should it be shorter? So the longer it is, the better it is. Why? Because just like you are giving an interest-free credit to your customers, your suppliers are giving you interest-free credit. And the greater this interest-free credit is going to be, the better it is going to be for the business. So when I talk about this payables payment period, so what happens is the longer the duration, the better it is. Then there is this inventory holding period, which actually shows you the time taken to sell, goods from the date of purchase. So what exactly is this inventory holding period? So the inventory holding period is the time taken to sell the goods from the date of purchase. Now let's try to understand this. So basically what happens is, the shorter the duration is, the better it is going to be, because that means your inventory holding cost would be lower. That means your inventory holding cost would be lower. So what is it? What is good for the business? What is good for the business is that the business should have a shorter inventory holding period. Why? Because if you have got a shorter inventory holding period, this is actually going to help your business in this way, that you will be able to. That means you will be able to reduce your holding cost. What is going to happen is you'll be able to reduce your holding cost. So these are the key ratios for the working capital that we have discussed. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to discuss one final ratio of the working capital, and which is a very important ratio. And that ratio is actually termed as working capital cycle. That ratio is termed as working capital cycle. We also call it cash operating cycle. Now, what exactly do you mean by this working capital cycle and cash operating cycle? So this working capital cycle or cash operating cycle is the time taken to recover $1 investment in working capital. The time taken to recover a dollar investment in working capital, that's what the working capital cycle is all about. So when we talk about the working capital cycle is the time taken to recover a dollar investment in working capital, that is considered to be a working capital cycle. Now, let's try to understand that how exactly do we calculate this working capital cycle. So the formula for calculating this working capital cycle is like this. The formula for the computation of the working capital cycle is actually like this. It's actually the inventory days plus receivable days less payable days. What is it going to be? It's going to be the inventory days plus the receivable days and less the payable days. Now, what exactly do you mean by this inventory days plus receivable days less the payable days? So for example, if you have got a receive inventory holding period of, let's say, 35 days, you have got a receivable collection period of, let's say, 30 days. And if you have got a payable payment period of, let's say, 40 days. So what is actually going to happen is there is going to be a 25 days working capital cycle. There's going to be a 25 days working capital cycle. So what is going to be there? There's going to be a 25 day working capital cycle. Now, let's try to understand what exactly do you mean by this. This would actually mean that if you invest the money in the working capital, it will take you 25 days to recover a $1 investment in working capital. It will take you 25 days to recover a dollar investment in the working capital. Now, try to understand something. Basically, what is going to happen is try to understand. You're standing here. You made purchases, and from the date of purchase till the date of sale, it took you 35 days. You made a purchase and from the date of purchase to the date of sale, it took you 35 days. And from the date of sale to the date of recovery, it took you 30 days. So basically, your inventory was held within your organization for, let's say, 35 days. This is basically the inventory holding period. This is the receivable collection period. And what you did was, you actually took 40 days to make payment. You actually took 40 days to make payment from the date of purchase. So this is actually going to be termed as payable period. So where your money was stuck for 65 days, you actually withheld the supplier's money for 40 days. So resultingly, you were standing at 25 days as the net. You were standing as 25 days as the net number of days for which your money is going to be tied in the working capital. Are you people able to understand this? Are you people able to understand this? So when we talk about the working capital cycle, the working capital cycle is actually that the working capital cycle or the cash operating cycle is the time taken to recover. The time taken to recover a dollar invested in your working capital. The time taken to recover a dollar invested in your working capital. Is it okay to everyone? Yeah, is it okay to everyone? Is everyone okay with this? Well, yes, this is also going to be compared with the industry because the or your past last year or so, because that's why, because you see what happens is, why do we need to compare this? We need to compare this because we need to have an idea if our organization is actually going on the right track or not. Why do we need to compare? Because we need to establish if our organization is actually going on the right track or not. So when we talk about the working capital management, the few things which are important is that, we should be able to understand. We should be able to understand that what are the key ratios with respect to the working capital management. Because once you know about the key ratios of the working capital management, so you would be able to know whether your organization is operating in a proper manner or it is not operating in the proper manner.